Welcome to the house of the Lord. Ooh, these are the days of Elijah.
These are days. See signs and wonders. You know, here not too long ago, they in the clouds, it looked like a city. And John said they have a new city coming down.
Yes.
So, soon and very soon, we might be seeing that
yes.
new city, or we might be seeing Jesus in the clouds. But the Bible says that, you know, in the last days, that we'll see signs and wonders, and also says that men's hearts will fail them for fear of the things that's coming upon the earth. But all down through history, God has spared his people. Sometimes in unconventional ways, you might say. Sometimes nature, sometimes giving them the ability to do things they couldn't do before. You know, Samson, he had supernatural strength.
Mm-hmm.
And the prophet, he used a raven to feed him during the drought.
Yes,
one prophet, he used a donkey to preach him a sermon, because there was an angel fixing to separate his head from his shoulders with a flaming sword. He didn't see it, but the donkey did. But all down through time, and I was seeing this deal the other night about World War II. These Polish soldiers had found this little bear cub that's almost dead from starvation, and you know, using, I don't know if it's real or not, or coronation, but condensed milk. They nursed it back to life, and of course it grew. And they thought it was just mimicking what they was doing. But it said it even, you know, it would wrestle with them, and it even learned to take a shower. And so, but they was fighting with the Allies, and they come under the Allies came under a heavy attack, and they was calling for more ammunition. And this group was called up to take them, and they was discussing, well, if we leave the bear here, if we don't make it back, he'll starve to death because he, you know, had been fed by man. He didn't know how to forge for himself. And so they decided, well, if we take him, he might get, you know, when bombs and shells are going off, he might get scared or he might even get hit. And so, but, you know, six in one hand, half dozen in another, the bear might get killed or die one way. But they decided to take the bear with them. And they was running and trying, they couldn't, they was falling behind, keeping the machine guns and all, and everybody, the mortars and everybody supplied with ammunition. And all of a sudden they looked around and here the bear was carrying boxes of ammunition. Now they thought he was just mimicking them, but I think God spoke to the bear to give some help. And they won the battle because the bear kept, he didn't just carry one box, he kept carrying until they all stopped. It impressed them so much they changed their patch and their uniform to a bear with a shell and even put it on their vehicles. God can use anything to meet your needs.
Yes.
He had Joseph, he gave him a dream. Said, don't, you know, told him to go down to Egypt. I got a cousin that he was building a church, and him and the other guy that's helping, they weren't carpenters. And they would work till they got to the point that they didn't know where or what to do next. And they would pray, and he'd go to home. And during the night, the Lord would give him a dream. He'd get up the next morning and say, now I don't know what to do. Every time they got stuck, they'd pray, and the Lord would give them a dream. So, you know, whether he sends angels, whether he sends a bear, a donkey, a crow, or a raven, whatever. If you will trust him, he'll meet your needs. You know, a friend of ours was a bomber pilot in World War II, They was flying low, keeping, trying to stay under the radar, flying creek beds and down treetop level. And he got hit in one engine, and he had already dropped his bombs, and he was trying to get back to base. And he looked over, and the other engine wasn't doing too good. But as he looked out to one engine, between him and the engine was an angel, and he saluted him. He looked over to the other one that was already stopped and was smoking. There was another angel, and he saluted him. You know, I first thought, well, they was just riding with him, but tonight I got a brand new thought. I think the angel was holding the plane up. And he said he made it back safe, had bullet holes in the plane, but none in him. And, you know, no matter what comes your way, if you trust the Lord, he's got the answer.
Yes,
He can keep your boat afloat, or he can keep your plane in the air, or he can, like 2 years ago when we was down in Texas, Joyce and Bobby and us, and all of a sudden we was coming on the interstate, and all of a sudden this 18-wheeler just shot across the on-ramp and stopped. And we missed him. But I think it was a hard it was close. But he will keep us if we'll trust in him, if we'll ask him. We learn sermon number one. Let's see, we're giving tithes and offerings. God got something to give to me. Oh, Bobby. Father, tonight we thank you because you are a God that we can trust. In a time of need, we can call on you and know that you will deliver us. Father, we just thank you tonight, Lord, for your many blessings and for this offering, Lord. And we know that you're going to bless in the giving tonight, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the
because many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, and now it is already in the world. You are from God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he who is in you. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
Is greater than he that is in the world, because greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. I was reading about some of the old masters of art, both sculpting and painting. And Michelangelo started out, finished many masterpieces, including the Sistine Chapel, which I am told he worked on for 4 years, and he was not lying down. I read another article that said he was not lying down on those scaffolds and doing this. He was standing up, painting those. And 4 years, he did this. And it's one of the most beautiful works in the world. And he left a lot of unfinished works, though. Have you ever done that? You started something and threw it in the corner? Said, nah, I'll start on something else. He left a lot of unfinished works that are being shown in a Florence, Italy museum. It is said he worked on 44 statues and completed 14 of them. I'm not sure if that number is exact. I've read a lot about four famous unfinished works that are over there in Florence, Italy. But he left some unfinished works. And I'm saying tonight, and what is on my heart, is to finish the work God gave us. We each need to be aware of what does God want of us and to finish that work that he has given us before we leave this world. Amen?
Amen.
So Michelangelo's potential was great. But those items in that Italy, Italian museum, unfinished works, our unfulfilled potential of a genius. He was literally an artistic genius. He was so good at what he was doing. And another one, Da Vinci. In 1481, he was commissioned by an Augustinian monk to paint the Adoration of the Magi, depicting three wise men, the arrival to see Jesus. And he worked on it and created a life-size draft that spanned over 7 feet. It's huge. But in the very next year, in 1482, the Duke of Milan commissioned him to paint the Last Supper. Ooh. And we all know that one, don't we? So he left the Adoration of the Magi, and someone else picked it up later and did it themselves, taking that commission, the Adoration of the Magi. But the Last Supper, he did finish, but he didn't finish the Adoration of the Magi. Have you ever thought about, Lord, I want to be complete in everything you've set for me to do in this life? He has given every one of us something that we need to complete. And we're working on it, but I want to complete it. Amen? Now, there's another, and I put a picture on your notes over there of the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. And this construction of this museum, of the New York's Metropolitan Museum of Art, it doesn't represent what it was started out to be. The concept was different at the first, but they went through a crisis, a financial crisis in 1901. And so then after that, they reinstated the work and completed in 1903. However, it was not as it was originally concepted to be. During this pause, you see there were four columns, and you can see it on that picture, and I'm sorry you in the stream can't see that. You can go to Wikipedia and you can see it, or any kind of book that's covering that. And anyway, you can see that before they stopped working on this museum of art,
they placed on the top of these pillars just big chunk of, whether it was marble or concrete or whatever it was, they put this big chunk of stone up there. And if you look real close, you can see it's just a mass of stone on top of those columns. Also, in between those columns was supposed to be a work of art. They never showed up. So that whole building stands there even today as an unfinished work. I don't want to leave anything unfinished. I want to finish the work that God sent me here to do. Start strong, stay strong, and finish strong by always remembering why you're doing it in the first place. Why are we doing this in the first place? I'm not here just to breathe well each day of the rest of my life. You're not either. And we have a lot to give. Each one of us, if you know Christ, you have a lot to give and to share in this life to someone else. And they're looking to us because there's a lot of crises going on out there. And people are looking to us because we have something. You have someone inside of your heart that everybody else that does not know him is hungry for. And they don't even realize what it is. I don't want my life to show up as an unfinished work in that last round. We lost a couple of days ago, a good friend, or yesterday evening, or the night before that, a good friend, Leo Potts. And it is a great minister, a wonderful man of God. And he always was excited, and I love that, and everybody else did too, because his excitement was contagious. It was wonderful. And no one dared ever try to be like Leo Potts, because he was an original. And so wonderful to be around someone that was so excited about everything. And just some of the things I remember back on that I won't share, but it's just funny. He could just flat out be funny and yet so contagious about God and God's word. And when I think about all of this, these plans for this New York Museum, Metropolitan Museum, they were set out to be done in a specific way, and the money ran out, and so these blocks that were on top of these columns went unfinished. Still unfinished. I don't know why they never sent somebody up there to finish them. You would think that someone would finish them. Maybe someone said, no, I don't want to do that job. I don't know. But these plans were never completed and finished as they should have been. And the blocks went unfinished. And the niches inside the columns still have no statue as they were supposed to. I want to talk to you tonight about unfulfilled potential being such a waste. Because every one of us have a potential to be great, to do something that God designed each one of us to do. I look at each of you and I think about you that's out there in the stream, hopefully in the stream, and hopefully more than even I know about. But I think about that. There's a lot of reasons for people to stop before they finish. I can think about you and I can think about what you're really good at. But you know what? It's so wonderful that what God calls us to is usually what we love doing. You know, there's a lot of messages go on on the golf course, isn't it? A lot of sermons get preached on a golf course. Do you know about Jesus? There's a lot of that that happens out there. And some people are really good at that. And it's a ministry. But you know, Bob, there's a lot of things that stop people, even when they love doing those things. Family background, look at me, I'm not good enough. Look at my family, they were not all that and a bag of chips. The money's not there. Not feeling good about my ability or the process of doing this. But I want us to look tonight at a man that I've dealt with very rarely in this ministry. His name is Jephthah. Jephthah was the son of Gilead. But his mother was a prostitute. So after he was born and he came in among the rest of the family, he had half-brothers. And the half-brothers decided they didn't want anything to do with him, and so they drove him away and said, you can't have inheritance with that. Your mother is a prostitute. Could he help it? Somebody say no. He couldn't help it at all. He must have given up on his heritage, though, because he went away. His brothers drove him away without that inheritance, and he must have given up on it or he would have stayed and fought for it. He had work to do in this land and in this family, and he allowed them to push him away. So I want you to read with me Judges 11. Scoundrels, you see, came to him after he went off from the family. And scoundrels followed him. Is that what he would be? A scoundrel? Would he ever climb above that? Would he ever be better than that? I'm telling you, God can use anybody for anything. Pastor Lewis began this message tonight appropriately when he said what the Lord had put on his heart. Jephthah the Gileadite was a mighty warrior. His father was Gilead. His mother was a prostitute. Gilead's wife also bore him sons. And when they were grown up, they drove Jephthah away. You are not going to get any inheritance in our family, they said, because you are the son of another woman. So Jephthah fled from his brothers and settled in the land of Tob, where a gang of scoundrels gathered around him and followed him around. But then the tables got turned. When his brothers needed him, and the fight was getting heavy, and they needed someone to fight for them. So verse 4 says, sometime later, when the Ammonites were fighting against Israel, the elders of Gilead went to get Jephthah from the land of Tob. Come, they said, be our commander so we can fight the Ammonites. And Jephthah said to them, didn't you hate me and drive me from my father's house? Why do you come to me now when we are in trouble? And the elders of Gilead said to him, nevertheless, we are turning to you now. Come with us to fight the Ammonites. And you will be head over all of us who live in Gilead. And he's been hurt once, so he's really careful about his heart now. And this is what happens. Jephthah answered, suppose you take me back to fight the Ammonites, and the Lord gives them to me. Will I really be your head? See, he's protecting his own heart there. They've been kicked out once. And the elders of Gilead replied, the Lord is our witness. We will certainly do as you say. So Jephthah went with the elders of Gilead, and the people made him head and commander over them. And he repeated all his words before the Lord in Mizpah. Yet, there are people right here in 2021 who have a great talent, great gifts inside of them, undeveloped gifts. Things that God has set inside, and yet some feel unworthy, some feel put out, some feel like they've been shut out. But there are masterpieces God wants to bring forth from his people. Masterpieces of work towards the end of the time is getting short. We have gifts, undeveloped gifts, and we need to use them for the glory of God. How do we discover and how do we develop them? Look at Jephthah. He was kicked out, and he had such great gifts. He said he was a warrior. And when the family got in trouble, they wanted that warrior back. But you know what? God wants us to be involved. God wanted Jephthah to be involved and fulfill his plan for Jephthah on this earth. We each have the plan of God that we must do. How do we discover and develop our gifts then? How do we do that? Number one, we need to look up to someone else that may be doing the same thing that we feel called to, and spend time with them. Let them help us. Let them mentor us. Let them bring us to that place where we're able to fulfill God's plan for our lives. Timothy did that with Paul. Joshua did that with Moses. Hello? Amen? The disciples did that with Jesus. So true. I spent a lot of time then and now sitting at the feet of Jesus over the lifetime I've had of ministering for him, and even before that call was set at his feet. When I knew that I knew that I knew that being a bookkeeper for a company downtown was not my calling, but was just a step to get there, I spent even more time at the feet of Jesus, but also listening to great ministries, preaching the gospel on TV and on tapes. So many ministers touched my life, and I listened. And I watched how they acted, how they did. So what is your calling? Every one of us have a calling in ministry in some way. We all do. We're ministers of the gospel of the Lord. Whether it's one-on-one, or it's from a pulpit, or from a head of a class, or if it's in our job out there that the Lord has set us there to be a light, his light in a dark world, a lighthouse, to keep people from hitting on the rocks. I listen to gospel preachers on the TV and on tapes. And I read and I read and I read and I read and I hungered. I wasn't ready yet, but I was planning on being ready when his time came. Second thing you need to do is to give up. You got to be willing to give up who you are to become who he wants you to be. Give up who you are. Because he will make you great in his kingdom, greater than you could make yourself. He will cause you to become. Did you know that Abraham gave up his home in order to go out where he didn't even know where he was going to go? That's scripture. He had to give up his home. He had a lot. But God said, go where you don't even know where you're going. And he said, yes, Lord. Moses gave up riches, the riches of Egypt, as Pharaoh's adopted grandson, to go and identify with the people of God, his heritage. We're the people of God. I don't care what brand you have on you. We're the people of God if Jesus lives and abides inside of us. Paul gave up the comfort of being a Pharisee to pay the price of being an apostle. And boy, he paid the price. I didn't give up an awful lot when I quit my job. I gave up the comfort of a warm house that first winter. It was cold, yeah, but I counted it as nothing. I sat by the fireplace because I knew we couldn't pay the electric bill. Because we were total electric back then, I think. Couldn't pay the bill if I just ran the whole house and got it warm. So I sat by the fireplace and I wore two robes, heavy robes. And I sat there and I read the word. And I listened to what God had to say to me. Give up. You have to give up who you think you are and become who he knows you are. Because he knows you best, and he knows you better. Then you show up. Let's go back to Jephthah. He's going to show up. Verse 35. Jephthah said, I have opened my mouth unto the Lord, and I cannot go back. Made a vow to God, and he kept it. It's hard, one of the hardest things any father could ever do. If you want to win, you've got to show up and do what you said you would do. You want to win in God's kingdom and be able, when he calls you home, to stand there and hear him say, you fought a good fight, you kept the faith. Enter now into the joys of the Lord your God. That'd be shouting time in heaven. That'd be shouting time. Because it'd all be over with the shouting then. In spite of Jephthah's family background, all his personal problems, he had some. The riffraff he had been hanging with. To find his potential, he had to show up. He became, get this, when he said, yes, I will. He became, Jephthah became, Israel's youngest judge. And he finished up somewhere called Faith's Hall of Fame in Hebrews 11. And to me, this means so much because here he was, cast out by his half-brothers because they didn't think he was good enough. Hello? A lot of people today feel that, I bet. But he landed in Hebrews 11, and I want to read it to you, that at least a portion from verse 30. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were encircled for 7 days. By faith, the harlot Rahab did not perish with those who did not believe, when she had received the spies with peace. And what more shall I say, for the time shall fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah. Wow. Jephthah's there. God had called his name and had his number. He wasn't too low to come up. He wasn't too far to come back. He wasn't so bad that God couldn't take everything and make it right. And he became the youngest judge. I like that when it shows up that God uses a young person. He's younger than all the other judges. You'd think, well, a judge needs to have some age and hello. But he was the youngest judge. And God knows what he's doing better than we do. Let God do it for you. I'll go on, it says, and Samson and Jephthah, also of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, worked righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of the lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, became valiant in battle, turned to flight, the armies of the aliens. Let God do it for you. Just let God do it for you. It's awesome. Philippians 1 and 6. I'm going to close with this. Philippians 1 and 6. Being confident of this very thing. Are we confident? God can do anything. God can do absolutely anything he wants to. He sent me around the world to preach the gospel, and I didn't know anybody. Hello. You have to have some kind of contacts. But God knows how to do better. Being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it or finish it, perfect it, until the day of Jesus Christ. He that has begun a good work in you will finish it. He's going to finish it. Let him. Let him. Be available all the time, wherever you are. Wherever. Riding down the road, we don't cuss the person that about hit us out. Doesn't work. It just hurts us. Let God do it. Be that person God has led you to be. Be. Sometimes it's hard. Sometimes you want to give them a piece of your mind. Hello? They don't want it. Wow. And God can do more in a moment than we can in a lifetime if we just apply ourselves. I let him bring us up to where he wants us to be. That person that he could use all the time, anytime, on time, he's an on-time God. And he can do anything. I always said he can take a sow's ear and make a silk purse out of it. I think that's what he did with me. He can do anything with what you give him. Give it to him. Let him work it. We're going to go to God in prayer. I pray that you take this lesson, speaking about finishing the work. We each have a time on this earth. Finish the work. Finish what he's given you. Be to someone else the Christ they need to see, the Spirit of Christ in you. Just be there for them. Ask God and he'll help you in every single way. He'll be right there. Father, right now we come to you and we ask you for your help to finish the work. There's a lot to be done, Lord. There's a lot to be done. And someone's got to step up and be available. Let your plan be settled forever within our hearts. And let us pursue the plan that you put there. Lord, we're trying. But let it be an even more desperate pursuit so that more will hear and will feel that there's something that can be done. Be the best we can be. With Christ living in us, we can. And in the name of the Lord Jesus, I speak over every single person that's hearing this, that they are brought up to a higher place in the Lord, that they are brought up into a place of a feeling that pursued in the name of the Lord Jesus. And let us all pursue, because the time is calling for it. In the name of Jesus. And Father, those that need a touch in their body, I speak over them for healing, health, and wholeness to cover them right now in the name of the Lord Jesus, for miracles to transpire. And Father, for anyone out there that does not know you, that Lord, they will say yes to you, and they will head towards your throne in saying, whatever you want me to do, yes, Lord, I'll do it. Lord, there's been, you've called home a great minister, and there's going to be someone else that needs to step up to the plate. Let them fulfill, let each person feel the need and reach for the fulfillment of as much as God has placed within each person to step up and do. your will and say, yes, Lord, whatever your will be done. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen and amen. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Let your will be done in me. Can you say that? Let your will be done in me. I only want to do your will in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. We're going to say bye to those that are in our stream tonight. Thank you for listening in and hearing this preacher out. It's what's been on my heart, and I can't get something done put there. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you Sunday.